Welcome to PPG World Services, bringing you the best of our industry to chat, chuckle and share. The weather here is absolutely gorgeous. I know where some of you are struggling with snow and all kinds of other stuff, so...
Your hearts out, because here in Florida and in Spain where Louise and I are, it's absolutely gorgeous. And Rebecca King's on the show with us today because pretty much nothing would work properly without old Rebecca being involved. So Rebecca's here, she's going to keep us on schedule, she's going to coordinate any questions and just make sure that we get this thing moving. So hey Bex, how you doing?
Good, how are you?
I'm good. Now you're not in the sun, are you?
No, I'm in the rain.
Oh no.
Sorry. So what are we doing today? Well, first of all, the whole point of doing this show is to do it once a month and to do it at 12 o'clock on a Sunday, so hopefully as many of you as possible can join us live. We are recording it, so it'll be available afterwards, and we'll put it up on our iTunes channel and make sure that it's readily available through iTunes. So we want to share the best of the best of PPG, of the membership, of the education, of everything great that's happening out there. So today it's Sunday, April 19th, and today we're going to have Ada Sims on the show. She's going to join us in about 25 minutes. Ada did a really nice article in Box from the Guild in the March edition about harnesses and collars. So I've asked Ada if she'll come on and join us, and we can have some great discussions. My personal belief is that collars are for tags, not that I don't think you should walk a dog on a collar, because I think if the dog walks great, you can walk it on whatever you like. But I think there are so many harnesses out there now. The industry's just boomed over the last 2 or 3 years. So Ada's going to share some insight with us. And we've also got Diane Garrod in the house today. Di is one of our founding members and PPG Steering Committee. And she's going to pop in a little bit later. So if any of you have questions for Di or Ada, Rebecca's going to coordinate that for you. So what else, Louise? I mean, that's pretty much it. We're up and running. So great. Good to be here.
We are absolutely up and running. We're going to be talking about dog bite prevention. I'm going to sort of interview you, Niki, because I want to tell everybody loads of different things about the Pet Professional Guild. So I'm going to be asking you some questions and put you on the spot.
Okay. Well, doesn't mean I've got to answer them, but fine.
You can always pass. I know.
Can I ask a friend or dial a neighbour or ask for some $1 million or whatever the rules of that crazy show are?
Absolutely. Well, Becca's there, so maybe you could go, hey, Becca.
Okay, we'll call it dial a Becca if we're not sure the answer. We'll just dial a Becca.
Yeah, okay. Good idea.
So, Louise, before we go any further, seriously, because I think a lot of people know who I am just because of the exposure I've had through PPG, but let's talk about you. I mean, you have been heavily involved in PPG for a long time now. You're based out there in Spain. You did some work with Nando and in the doghouse, but you spent a lot of time talking about Jambo and breed-specific legislation. So tell everybody about Jambo. Who's Jambo?
Okay, well, Jambo is my little Staffordshire Bull Terrier. He's now nearly 3 years old, actually. He's the first Staffordshire Bull Terrier to be a trick dog champion, and obviously he's trained for spree. However, despite his good nature and his good training, unfortunately in Spain, yes, we have breed-specific legislation, and so he has to live with certain restrictions. He has to stay on the lead when we go out, he has to be muzzled. I have a license, a dangerous dog handler's license. He's also licensed as or registered as a dangerous dog. He's got his own Facebook page, and the reason why we did that, to be honest, was to, well, for a couple of reasons really, to sort of show people what can be achieved with force-free training, because the fact is, at 15 months old, he was the first Staffordshire Bull Terrier to be a trick dog champion, and we did all that without using any force whatsoever. So getting that message out there to people, I do think that's really important. You know, what? Just look, here's the evidence. This is what you can do without using any force.
Isn't, you know, show and tell is so important, because we can all be on our pedestals and chanting about force-free training and we don't need aversives and these tools are archaic and it's cruel, but at the end of the day, we're going to be judged by what we actually do and walking the walk. So I think it's really important. And you and I have had this conversation before that, you know, for people that have these dogs that are deemed dangerous by others who don't understand, I think it's really important that each and every one of you make it your responsibility to just be an ambassador for the breed, to make sure that as many people as possible see these dogs for what they are, just for wonderful family pet dogs and for their fantastic abilities.
I couldn't agree with you more. And the fact is, like, Jumbo's a trick dog, but there are police dogs, search and rescue dogs, there are, you know, sniffer dogs, there are dogs, agility dogs, there are these dangerous dogs doing all these incredible things. And then there are all the dogs that are happily living in family homes that are, you know, that absolutely superb pets. Mm-hmm. And I think you're so right. It is. You know, come on, let's show everybody what these dogs are capable of.
Yep. I'm just wondering if we shouldn't maybe in the future get somebody on the show and specifically talk about BSL and how, you know, without being too judgmental, how bloody ridiculous it really is. I mean, maybe we should have a whole show on just on that total topic.
I think that would be really good, especially it sort of links in as well with the dog bite prevention, because let's face it, any dog can bite. And I think BSL makes people think, well, okay, it's okay, we've restricted those dogs that bite, so, you know, okay, we're all right, this is a retriever or a spaniel, or so they're not dangerous. And I do think that there is this belief with certain people that these dogs are dangerous dogs and that we would be better off without them, and it's so untrue.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you know what? We're going to come back to that topic on dog bite prevention, because it's actually on our schedule today, and we want to talk about Dog Gone Safe and the great job they're doing. So we'll come back to that. And with that, to sort of segue into the other item we wanted to talk about, is what's coming up on PPG World Services in the future. What do we have coming up in the next few months? Because, you know, given that dog bite prevention is March through May, maybe we should look at in May having Joe Nora or Jennifer Schrock on the show so that they can talk a bit more about that. So we can cover it from our perspective in terms of awareness today, but maybe it's worth us revisiting that. So what have we got coming up? I mean, who's on our first real show next month?
Our first real show is we've got Laura Joseph. She's going to be in the house talking to us all about target practice and targeting and stationing, as well as, let me think, I think she's very involved with birds of prey.
She is. Pigs.
I
got to tell you, Angelica and I went to the Pet Expo in Tampa 2 weekends ago. We actually went there specifically to look for potential local vendors for the summit, which we're going to talk about later.
Uh-huh.
And there was a pig rescue there, and oh my God, I would have just torn my marriage license up there and then. I almost brought one of those darn things home. I mean, Rick would have been out of this building as quickly as you can say, get out of the building. Uh-huh. But, oh my God, these miniature pigs are so cute, and they're becoming so popular as pets now. And Angelica actually sent me a photograph last night of a pig that was at her place to having agility lessons. I mean, they're becoming so popular because they're so smart and so intelligent.
Absolutely. You wouldn't believe it, actually. Our local vet, the girl that works on the reception there, she's got a pet pig, and she's been doing tricks with him.
Well, I paid $20 to get kissed on the nose by a pig, and I didn't want to wash my face afterwards. I was very proud.
Awesome.
Absolutely delightful. So, yeah, Laura's coming in the house. And, you know, the topics that she's going to be talking about, targeting and training, I mean, we're going to look at it from a different perspective, because even though, you know, the mechanics and the science and the learning theory is all the same, obviously the logistics of how you do that with birds and pigs is a little bit different, because they're not dogs. They're not quite as amenable. They don't, you know, they don't live with us in the same way necessarily. So it's like Terry Ryan always says, one of the great things about the clicker camps is that you're working with animals that don't care about us necessarily. So you've just got to get everything else right. I'm sure that's not the same with pet birds and pigs. Di Garrod also works with birds. Maybe we'll ask Di when she comes on a little bit later. But, we see some fantastic videos. And actually, the video that won our International Celebration of Force-Free Training Day was a pig doing agility.
It was, wasn't it?
Maybe we're going to have to create a new membership level in PPG. And Violet Michaels reached out to me a few weeks ago. She was also talking about a new client with a pig, and I tried to link her up with some other members that have done a lot of work with pigs. So obviously they're becoming more and more popular. I mean, it's something that more and more dog trainers are being asked to help and get involved with, is training pet pigs. So,
and do you think that's a good thing that they're becoming more popular?
I don't know. I mean, look, at the end of the day, you know, I'm an animal lover. I mean, I've had miniature donkeys and horses. I mean, I got 4 pet chickens right now that are going to star in our chicken camp that come when they're called. And, you know, if I had my way, they'd be in the house. Obviously, Rick puts his foot down on that. But, so I think at the end of the day, and I also do have fairly strong feelings about zoos. Having lived in Africa for 20 years, I like to see animals living in their natural environment. But I think there are certain animals, if they're getting the mental enrichment and they're getting the physical stimulation and everything's right, then I don't see why not. At the end of the day, you just got to ask yourself, are you doing the best for the animal? Is the animal having a great life? Is it living a stress-free life? Is it all the animals' needs being met? And some of the pet pigs that I've seen, absolutely they are. I mean, they're far happier than if they were living in a sort of a backyard, you know, pig farm, yeah, where, you know, where they were getting neglected. So, but with that said, I'm not an expert, so that's, you know, just my humble opinion.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with what you're saying, actually, because it does come down to that. It comes down to the quality of life, the enrichment. Yeah, absolutely.
Everything else, yeah. Uh-huh. So who's next? And in June, we've got Linda Michaels. Linda Michaels is coming on.
Well, in May as well, before we get to Linda Michaels, in May we've also got Lisa and Brad Wagoner.
Oh, that's right. That's right. Yeah. They have some great programs. Their webinars are always very popular with our members. So,
I was just the other day, actually, I watched one of their webinars kindly put out through the PPG. So thank you very much for that. I was watching their Rocket Recall webinar. Great stuff. Loved it.
Excellent. Excellent. Yeah, I think, Becca, have they done their paddleboard webinar? Has that been done yet?
Yes, we did it in March.
Okay, they also did a webinar on how to get your dog to go paddleboarding, so, which I kind of had a chuckle about that when I saw it listed, because when I went to the UK last year to visit my parents, I spent the whole 3 weeks going, paddleboarding, really? Is that a sport? I just don't get it, but it's one of those things. It's just so popular now, so standing up on a paddleboard, go figure, whatever tickles your fancy, I guess.
There are people now that do yoga on stand-up paddleboards, so there you go. Wrap your brain around that one.
As they're actually going down the river?
I think it's more on lakes and calm water, but balance.
So they're not actually moving on it then?
No, but they're having to add that extra dimension of balance to stay on the board while you're moving through yoga poses.
Oh, but so for those of you out there that do yoga, I know a lot of our members do yoga. I see their Facebook posts. Leslie, you should be maybe looking at doing some yoga on a paddleboard. She lives near the water. She's moving down to Florida this year, hopefully. So we'll get Leslie out there on a paddleboard to show us some of her yoga moves. Oh, my goodness. Whatever you want to do. Hey, you know, I always say, as long as you're out there doing something, that's great. Good luck to you. All the best.
Absolutely, but I've got to admit, I think I struggle on the paddleboard. I haven't got the sense of balance to do yoga on it at the same time. My gosh.
Yeah, well, I'm fairly athletic. I always have been, but I'm also blessed with the touch clumsiness gene, so there's no way I'd be getting on a paddleboard doing yoga. I fall off my flat shoes given half the chance. I'm really clumsy.
Yeah, snap. I'd say exactly the same. I'm reasonably athletic, etc., but no, my sense of balance. Put a pin on the floor in front of me and I'll trip over it. So.
Well, I tell you what, I am looking to Linda Michaels. I'm looking forward to seeing Linda on the show. Linda and I know Linda. We chatted a few times and emailed, and Linda's going to come on and talk about her open letter to research that was featured in Barks. This was a letter that came about from, I think, the Sparks Convention. I think it's a really well-done piece. I think it asked some serious questions. I think it basically asks of our scientists that if you're going to make statements, make sure they're accurate. And when you are a scientist or anyone in a public position, you have an obligation, we believe, to make sure that everything that you are promoting is to the benefit of the animal. So that's going to be really interesting. And then to back that, Annie Phoenix is going to be on. Annie's a hoot, so we'll really enjoy chatting to Annie. She's going to come on and talk about a couple of her most recent articles and what she's up to in the dog world, because I've heard there's a book on the horizon. So maybe it's a rumor, maybe it's not. Hopefully Annie will give us some more information about that when we chat to Annie in June. And then July, we've got Bob Levinson coming on. Bob's going to talk about some obedience and rally stuff. So that'll be good. And then obviously, the rest of the year, the schedule's clear at this point. So if anybody wants to come join us, if you have something you want to share or you would like us to feature a particular topic, then shoot either Louise or I an email and we'll get it up on the schedule and we'll get you scheduled to come on and join us.
Absolutely. Yeah, we've also got Christine Yonkers scheduled to come on, I think, in July. So she's going to be talking about an article that she had in the January Barks from the Guild called Ditching the Pinch.
Okay, which great.
Actually, I think Diane had a recent article as well about pinch collars. So, you know, maybe we can talk to Di a little bit about that too.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Okay, so what else are we doing? Well, I guess, should we do me and then we can move on to some more interesting people?
Are you saying you're not interested?
Well, it's kind of blah, 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 blah. Yadida. Yadida.
Well, don't worry. I'm not that bothered about you, Niki. What I'm wanting to know about is the Pet Professional Guild. And I realise that today, probably the people that are listening live know exactly what the Guild is. But this is going to be going out recorded versions so that people can listen to it on iTunes. So can you tell me, for those people who don't know, what is the Pet Professional Guild?
Okay, well, the Pet Professional Guild is an association. It's a membership association. It's a 501c6 nonprofit, and it's an association where all force-free pet professionals can gather, and hopefully the goal is to further our mission and to further our industry. So it's to create an educational platform, not just to pet professionals, but also to pet owners. So alongside obviously getting directory listings, there's a lot more going on. I mean, it really is about building a strong platform and aligning people so that as we come together, our voice is so much stronger and travels so much further. So to be a member, we have a definition for force-free. Excuse me. And I'm going to talk about this for a minute because there's been so much stuff on Facebook, you know, blogs and all kinds of stuff about, oh, I don't call myself a force-free trainer. Or I'm not force-free, or, you know, force-free is kind of extremism. We're not an extreme elitist organization. We're an inclusionary organization. We have a provisional membership level that is designed for people that philosophically agree with our guiding principles but don't yet have the skills, so they can come into the organization and we can then support them with the education. Our goal is to educate and engage. So for us to be an exclusionary organization would just not make any sense. It would actually sabotage our mission. So our definition of force-free, because I know it's a word that's thrown around a lot, is no shock, no pain, no choke, no fear, no physical force, no physical molding or compulsion-based methods are employed to train or care for a pet. So somebody posed the question, well, what does that mean? Does that mean that I can't restrain my dog at the vet? No, no, no. It means that when you are, as a professional, when you're caring for an animal, when you're training an animal, you don't employ any tools or any methods or philosophies that are going to in any way put that animal in a situation that it wants to avoid or escape what you're doing. So everything is about understanding and meeting the needs of the pet. Now, of course, there's going to be situations where, for safety, you know, here's a question. If a dog's running out to the road, would you try and tackle it to stop it if it was going to get run over by the number 52 bus? Of course you would. You wouldn't use that as part of your training tool, but in emergency situations, you do whatever you need to do to save an animal's life. So, you know, with some husbandry issues, some vets don't like going to the vet. So maybe the vet has to restrain them. Is that ideal? No. And counter to that, we should be then putting protocols in place to help the animal to overcome that fear. But if an animal has to go to the vet and has to have some type of veterinary procedure done, then, you know, there are situations where you may have to physically restrain, and then even chemically restrain. So our definition is very clear. It means when you're training a pet, when you're caring for a pet, you're not going to use any of those tools, and you're going to employ methods that are void of fear, of physical molding, which means, you know, you're not just going to slam a dog's back into the ground to get it to sit, or some of the more archaic things we've seen people do. So that's our definition of force-free. Now, the non-negotiables are shock, prong, choke, fear, force, molding. But there are some sort of gray areas, because some people will say, well, a gentle leader is force. Any equipment is force if it's not used properly. I mean, hopefully we'll talk to Ada about that in a few minutes. So it's making sure that the equipment that we use is conditioned properly so that the animal actually enjoys participating in the use of it rather than it being an aversive tool or application. But there are some non-negotiables, like I said, that's no shock, no pain, no choke, no fear, no physical force. The compulsion-based methods. So we're a member association, and we're growing. I mean, we also have membership level for pet owners, which is great because we get our pet owners involved, and we can link them up with pet professionals that can help service their needs, whether it's parrots, pigs, dogs, cats, horses, whatever. So it's just great.
Great stuff. And for the I'm not going to say for a professional here, because most of the professionals know what the advantages are, but I will come back to that actually. But for the normal, let's say the pet dog owner or the pet cat or pet rabbit owner, what are the advantages of them joining?
Well, if you're a pet owner, you do get access to some vendor discounts. You obviously get Box and the Guild, and you get communication, so you understand and you get to know what's going on in the industry. We do also have webinars that are discounted for them. So we're always looking at creating new things that our pet owners can also benefit from. But it's about joining a community. It's about joining a community where together, whether you own a dog or whether you are professionally involved in the industry, we can all start to sort of mark out our territory and say, look, these methods are no longer acceptable. We're in the 20th century. Come on, guys. Let's look at moving this industry forwards. Let's try and generate some agreed upon guiding principles for how we all perform within our industry.
Absolutely. And that is, it is so important, so important. Yeah. So I'm going to sort of go on from that a little bit. You just said you're growing quite rapidly. In fact, you've just launched your first international chapter, haven't you, in Australia? Behind the decision to do that? Why has the PPG got, don't get me wrong, it was already global anyway, but why did you see the need to launch an international chapter?
Well, right from the very first day when I sat on my sofa and wrote the guiding principles, it was always our goal to be as broad and as wide as we could be. There was never, and we always said we want to go internationally, which is why we've encouraged international members, and we have a lot of international members. The second goal was always to open local chapters, but we can't open local chapters outside the US until our foundation's strong in the US. So it took us 2 years to get to a point now where, you know, Becca and I are not working 20-hour days, literally keeping up with everything and developing stuff, and the steering committee, you know, are super, super busy working on programs. And the timing was right because an organization in Australia was licensing through Delta, and they basically, many of their board were members of PPG, and they approached us and said, look, we'd like to change our name and rebrand and relicense. And we were just like, absolutely. So we're now going through that transitionary process. So the timing was right, but it's always been our goal. And hush, hush, big hush, hush, but we are opening in Europe a big PPG in the next 2 or 3 weeks. And that's all I'm going to say on it, but it's really exciting. We already have a steering committee in place, and I'm so pleased with the steering committee. We have some fantastic people on the steering committee. We have some fantastic people on the steering committee of the PPG US, for want of a better word. And we've always been very fortunate that we've had great people working really hard to get everything done. But I invited seven people, and they all said yes. And then we had a clandestine call a couple of weeks ago where I basically told them what I was looking at, and they were all just like, we're in.
Okay, so maybe if you told me a few of these people's names, I could sort of work.
No.
Oh, shucks.
I'd only have to say one, and you'd immediately know exactly where it is, so no.
Right, so yeah. I guess you're just going to have to wait a little bit longer.
Yeah, but it's coming very soon. Yeah, let me say this as well. It's not our goal to go everywhere in the world. It's our goal to fill vacuums. So, and let me use Germany as a good example. There's three or four really nice organizations in Germany that do a really good job right now representing the force-free professionals. So we're not going to move into Germany because, number one, we wouldn't want to dilute what they're already doing, and number two, they're already fulfilling the need. So we're just looking at growth where we feel it's needed. And when I spoke to these first few people about this new PPG, the first question I asked was, do you think it's needed? Because if not, then we'll look at putting our resources elsewhere. So, yeah, and we do. We want to partner and align ourselves with other organizations that are doing a really super job. We don't want to go into competition with them. We want to partner and support other organizations. So it's an exciting time with PPG. We're having a lot of fun with it. I hope our members are enjoying it and having fun with it as well. There's so much really good stuff to come.
There is so much stuff going on at the moment. In fact, I was going to say to you, you recently partnered with Victoria Stillwell, didn't you? Can you tell me what that's all about?
Well, really, actually, we had a conversation with Victoria, it was not supposed to be that long, and we were on the phone for a couple of hours. It was a great conversation, and I realized that her organization and PPG were so aligned in terms of the goals. So I invited Victoria to be on our special counsel, which is an honorary position. There's not any work involved. It just basically means that you approve of what we're doing and you want to support us. But I actually have a call scheduled with Victoria and Van, I believe, next week. To look at other ways and other things that we can do to really help support both organizations. So I'm hoping that some really fun and exciting stuff comes out of that.
Okay, cool. So watch this space. As always, you keep leaving us with these little morsels of information and what's happening. Okay, something that I do know about that is definitely happening, that is not a secret, First Annual Force Free Summit Tampa, Florida, November time. Come on, can you tell us a little bit more about it and perhaps name a few names for people that don't know about some of the professionals that are going to be there giving lectures, etc.
I'm telling you, I am so excited about this. So first of all, Dr. Karen Overall is going to be there on day one. She's doing a four-hour presentation. So the whole of the morning of day one will be Dr. Karen, Dr. O. And what a fantastic ambassador for us and for what we do. And just love her to bits. She's great. We have five sessions working at the same time for 3 days. So there's a lot of stuff going on. We are going to be recording it all through Towser, so there will be a DVD available. But we're also going to be live streaming two of the rooms. That's new information that hasn't officially gone out there yet. So we're currently working with a company to just finalize the quotations because it's pretty expensive. So I'm hoping that by doing that, we can get those great sessions out to people that can't, because of the geographical location, can't or cannot get to the summit. So collectively, if you buy into the live streaming, you will get a free copy of the DVD of the entire session. We're hoping to put, and you know, with everything we do at PPG, we try and cost everything as low as we can, because we're not here to make profit out of our membership. We're here just to provide great services, great education, not just to our members, but to anyone that wants to learn about force-free training. So we've got lecture sessions that are 2 hour slots. We've got Ken McCourt's going to be in the house every single day, Laura Joseph, Jacqueline Monero is going to be here talking about cats, Nancy Tucker's going to be here talking about the good enough, redefining what a good dog trainer is, Deb Milliken, one of our steering committee members from Australia, who's coming all the way over for the summit with a couple of her colleagues, is going to do a great presentation on the winds of change, teaching the crossover journey. Diane Garrod will be there doing her Canine Emotional Detox. I mean, this list goes on. We've got Maureen Backman, the Wagners, Lisa Morrissey, Jennifer Schreyock, Diane Papper. I mean, just goes on and on. And then the most exciting for me is all the labs we've got. We wanted this to be a very interactive, and really the whole concept was about fun, introducing fun, because training should be fun. I mean, this should be fun for the people, fun for the owners, fun for the dogs. So Pat Miller is going to be there doing a couple of different sessions. Emily Lalam is going to be there. I had the pleasure of meeting Em last year when she came out here to do her two-day workshop. Teresa McEwen is going to be here doing a tag lab. Pamela Johnson is going to be here. Bob Levinson, Angelica Steinker, Chirag Patel, Sherry Sprague. Ooh, the list goes on and on and on. And then at the end of every day, we've got all five rooms. I'll do 30-minute sort of bite-sized sessions where we've got some other people that are not so well-known in the industry but have a lot to contribute are going to be in those rooms doing that. So, and then we've got our great dinner where we're all going to get together, hopefully, and hopefully not too many people end up in the swimming pool because it's around the pool. It's going to be a lot of fun. I mean, the whole concept of it is just education and fun, fun, fun.
And if people want to actually sign up to go, where can they do that? You're telling me all about it. So how do we get on board and how do we get out there to Tampa, Florida?
Go to forcefreesummit.com. That's the URL that will get you straight to the registration page. There's three different packages. There's financing available for members. Becca's doing an awesome job with financing. So for people that missed out on the Master Eve package for the 10-month financing, if they still want to sign up, Becca can work out some really good financing. It's interest-free financing. We're not making any money on the financing. We'll just figure out a way to divide it between how many months are left so that everybody pays up before the summit. So.
Great stuff. So no reason for anybody not to be getting on board with that, because I've seen myself, there are some great great packages available. You can go and just take part in the listen to the lectures, take part in the labs, or you can get all your meals, or you can get all your hotel. So yeah, excellent. There's a package for everybody.
There sure is. Excuse me, there sure is. Yeah, and there's so many people that are coming. I look through the list and I just think, I can't wait to meet these people, because we see each other every day on Facebook and we email, and it's just going to be so nice to be in. There's going to be so much energy in this place. I mean, the roof is going to rise off the building. There's going to be so much positive energy there. It's going to be awesome.
It is going to be absolutely amazing. And I tell you what, actually, the fact that you've said that you are going to be live streaming as well, I think that is great for people that, you know, do live further afield and perhaps can't get to Florida. They're not going to, well, they are going to miss out. I'm not going to say they're not going to miss out. Of course they are. But, you know, at least they will, I think, get, gosh, what can I say? Like, to not be able to take part is one thing, but to totally miss it is another. So I think that's great that people can watch. But you did tell me, and I'm not sure whether I'm allowed to say this or not, but you did tell me that you might be coming to Europe next year. Can I say that? I just did.
You can. Yeah, actually, our goal is in 2016 to try and do a summit in the US and in Europe, and at the back end, we're hoping to get over to Australia. So, yeah,
it's well, Australia too.
Yeah, but to be honest with you, you know, let me just first of all do a shout out for the people that are on our summit committee, because I can't tell you how much work they put into this. I mean, I knew it was going to be hard work. I had no idea it was going to be as hard as it was, but it's like knocking your head against a brick wall some days. And while I say that, I'm also just going to spend 60 seconds now and talk about the Clicker Company, because one thing we wanted to do on this show was talk about some of the great vendors that support our organization. And the Clicker Company has been there from month one or two, giving our members discounts on clickers. And they're going to be at the summit. They're going to have a booth there. They're going to have some great giveaways. So they are the number one seller of imprinted clickers. So if you want to buy clickers with your logo on it or your name, then go to clickercompany.com. Members get 5% discount. And they've also got some great, there's other things they're selling now, like treat bags and target sticks that you can also get logoed. So they have some great, great, great things. So Clicker Company is one of our vendors. We're going to feature them a lot more over the next few months. They're going to be in the house at the summit. So if you are a member, please go benefit from those discounts. And if you're not a member, just go there anyway. They have some great products. We've been buying off them for years. They're a really good company to work with.
Awesome. So that's the Clicker Company, yeah?
The Clicker Company, yeah.
Clicker Company. Cool. Okay, well, that doesn't get you out of answering more questions, because I've still got a couple of questions to ask you. I want to know, I've been hearing all about the Pet Professional Accreditation Program. What's it all about? What's going on? Come on, info please. Can I have some updates, some news?
Okay, you can. All right, you can. It's rolling out in about, what's the date? 19th. We're hoping to get this rolled out 31st of this month. We are actually doing pilot testing the exam next week or the week after. We've invited a certain number of people to get involved in the pilot. The pilot of the exam is not to test the testers, it's to test the exam. So what do I mean by that? 2.5 years ago, actually I think it was almost 3 years ago, Deb Milliken, myself and Carol Hussein had a meeting about some type of credentialing program for force-free professionals. And we discussed what we would want this program to look like. And it became obvious very quickly that if we were to do it and do it properly, it was going to be a lot of work. And at the time, we weren't really sure if it was something we should be getting ourselves involved with, because it really, yes, it's great and it'd be great for our industry, but we just opened PPG. So all the focus had to be on making sure that we gave value to our membership. We had a few more meetings and we sort of jotted down what we felt a professional dog trainer or dog behavior consultant should know in terms of skills, knowledge and experience. And then we left it for several months and people asked about it and we said no, it's not what we want to be putting our resources right now. And Deb and I, whenever we chatted, it would come up in conversation and we'd sort of throw more stuff into the pool, and this file started getting larger and larger. And we were hoping that other organizations or other people would sort of step up and get a credential that we felt proud to carry in terms of being force-free, and it just hasn't happened. So about 18 months ago, we decided that let's relook at this. Let's have a look at it. So Deb Mulliken, myself, Angelica Steinker, and who else? And that was it. We sort of got back together again and said, okay, let's relook at what we're doing here. So we put a lot more work into writing what they call a job task analysis, which was about 18 pages broken down between learning and behavior, communication and social behavior, you know, science, practical method, across all the different dimensions. And we realized we had a really great document, and it got passed around some other experts, and we ended up with a document we were really proud of. So then we decided, okay, now is the time. So at that point, we got some more people involved. Diane Garrod got involved, Catherine Zahner, Susan Nilsson, a few other people from our steering committee. And we started to develop the questions. And we also brought on board an examination company that deals in psychometrically sound, legally defensible professional credentials. So that took months. Can't tell you how long that process was, because not only did we have to develop the right questions, but each question had to link back to a point on the JTA. It had to be very scientifically done, had to be all very objective, not discrete data in terms of yes or no answers. It had to be 100% correct. And that's, we've gone back and forth on that for months, and we've now got an exam. And the exam is now being piloted in the next couple of weeks, and it's being piloted by people that are eligible to take the certification. So a lot of people wanted to get involved with the piloting but didn't have the level of experience, and we had to say, look, no, because you're really not doing us any favors, because we need to see how this exam is going to perform, given its performance being taken by the type of people that really are eligible for the credential. So that's being done in the next couple of weeks, and when that's done, all the other components are pretty much ready to go. So we're going to be rolling that out. So it is a different company to PPG. It's a nonprofit. It's actually doing business as. Non-PPG members can apply for it, but they have to meet the eligibility requirements, which is they have to sign off on the guiding principles, and they'll be held accountable. So it's basically a certification program that is advocating for skill competency, consumer transparency, and professional accountability. So the skill competency comes through the development of the correct psychometric exam. The consumer transparency is because of the eligibility requirements and the rigidness of how people will be held accountable once they've got the credential. And then the accountability, because if people are not fulfilling the requirements of the eligibility, it will be taken off them. So it's really, really proud of it. It's a great, I think it's a fantastic program. We can ask Diane Garrod about it in a few minutes, but I think all of us are really proud of what's been developed, and I think people are going to really enjoy it. So I'm not going to give you the name or any of the details at this point, because we're going to roll that out with a big bang, but it's coming very soon.
Absolutely great. And people will then know that if somebody has got this accreditation, that they deserve it. They've not just paid us money or whatever, which people do for other.
And here's the most important thing. It is independent of any school or any educational institute. So it's not affiliated with anything. So it is a standalone credentialing program. So, and it always will be. And anyone that's been involved in developing it cannot spin off any type of educational program in the next year saying, oh, come join us, we'll help you get through the blah, 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 blah. So that it always retains its integrity, and the ethics around it are just completely 100%.
Yeah. And presumably the eligibility for actually taking the accreditation is going to be quite high. Because you want to ensure. Absolutely. Yeah, I can see that you need to make sure that the people that gain the accreditation actually deserve it.
Absolutely. And it's also going to be very affordable. It's going to be very, very affordable. Again, we're not out to make money from it. We're out just to provide a great accreditation service for force-free professionals. And we're rolling out this year a dog trainer and dog behavior consultant, and then next year we're rolling out cat consultant and pet care, professional pet care accreditation. so that we can start to put some credentials, real credentials, into the pet care business, you know, daycare facilities, dog walkers, pet sitters, etc.
Okay, great stuff. Sounds absolutely amazing. Just tying in with that, actually, I was reading something the other day. Well, actually, every time I do a webinar, I see something about CEUs and do I want to claim CEUs. And I'm thinking that what you're talking about now, because it's to do with education, you might be able to tell me, well, why exactly would I want CEUs?
Well, most credentialing organizations, as part of the eligibility, they want to make sure that as a professional you have maintained a level of academic education, or you've attended workshops, you've watched webinars. So you're basically staying abreast. So you're staying abreast in your industry. So PPG has continued education, and it's attached to everything it does, because the Karen Prower Academy, their graduates need it, the IABC and the CCPDT. So now any webinar, anything on the PPG website that has CEUs for any other organization automatically has the same CEUs applied for PPG. So as a PPG member, if you've watched, you know, 24 of our free webinars over the last 2 years, then you now have collected 24 CEUs.
Do you actually have to collect them, or?
Well,
for
PPG, we give certificates, just automatically give certificates. For some of the other organizations, you have to go to their website and type in a code that then allocates it.
Okay, and I obviously understand that they are continued education units. Is it something, though, that is a CEU, is it specific to the States, to America, or?
I don't know. That's a really good question. I don't know. I mean, if you've not heard of it, then maybe it is. Maybe it is something. But, you know, like with the CCPDT, if you are a certificate, every 3 years when you renew, you have to show proof of 36 CEUs to show that since you took the exam and during those last 3 years, you have continued to educate yourself in some form or manner. So, I mean, I like the system. I think it's a good system. And I think with the way PPG delivers webinars, we make it very easy for our membership to get their CEUs, because between the free webinars and the very affordable webinars, you know, if you did one a month six a year, by the end of 3 years, you should be pretty much covered.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I see them on every webinar that I do, which is quite a lot. Something that I've ever, you know, concerned myself with, because although I do continue my education, I didn't think that I needed CEUs. It's like, what are these? You know.
Well, there you go. You better start getting them so you can apply for the credentials.
Can I back claim?
Anything in the last 3 years. Yeah, absolutely you can.
Oh, I've got it. Just ask Becca the amount of webinars that I've watched and the courses that I've attended. Wow.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Oh,
so surely we've heard enough of my voice. Let's grab Ada. Where's Ada? Let's get Ada on and let's talk to Ada about this great short article she wrote for Barks. Ada!
Hi, how are you?
I'm great. Well, it must be like 3 years since you and I last chatted.
Yes, it's been a while.
I remember walking around my pet resort in Oxford, Mississippi. It was an awful winter day on the phone with you, and I always remember that phone call. It was only 2 or 3 months after we opened PPG, I think.
Yes, it was. It was in the beginning.
Great. So you're very active on Facebook, so I'm all up to date with what you're doing. I follow you. I love some of the stuff you're doing with puppies.
So. Well, thank you.
Thanks for all the great work you do.
Oh, I love it.
So tell us about this Ask the Dog. What was the motivation behind writing this?
Well, the motivation behind writing it was the experience I had with my dog, reactive dog. The first 2 years, I was told to use a choke collar, then a prong collar, and alpha rolls. Because of these collars, when I would go to class and he wanted to go see another dog, I would pop the prong. And of course, he paired the pain with seeing another dog.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, it led to him being dog reactive that I couldn't even go to class anymore. So I decided to educate myself on learning theory, dog behavior, and truly the pressure on the neck was causing a monumental issue with him, and therefore I started to investigate harnesses. And the first one out on the market at that time was the sensation harness. So I went to using that, relieving the pressure off his throat, and started using behavior modification, desensitization, counter conditioning, and it was just a world of change for him. Since then, I've probably got 20 harnesses in the house. I've bought every single one and tried them all. So just the difference in yep. seeing the dog not react because I wasn't hurting him. He didn't feel strain on his throat. And with the no-pull or front attachment harness, it just turned the dog around. And when the dog turned around, there was always a reward for him.
And I think as well, Ada, what a lot of people miss out is that the leash becomes the actual antecedent for the behavior.
Absolutely.
I mean, it becomes a trigger, and sometimes just, you know, removing that or relocating that to another area just can stop with the actual, that illicit behavior. So there's a great graphic here that I'm reading. It was actually done by Laurie. I love Laurie Stevens. Laurie was out here a few weeks ago doing a two-day course. And what's the name of Laurie's harness?
It's called the balance harness.
Balance harness. Okay. How do you think the balance harness compares?
I actually prefer this okay. one. There's similar harnesses out there, but I find that Lori's is most affordable. It's right. under $30.
Right. But I've heard some really good stuff as well about Nancy Yamin's reins system. I've not used it, but Angelica, who I respect in terms of equipment, she uses it and she just loves it for her larger dog.
Yes, I did order that.
Sorry to interrupt. What was that you were just saying?
That Nancy Yamin develops a harness called Dog Reins that's designed for large dogs. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm hearing some really good stuff. I'm very fortunate because I live on 23 acres. My dogs don't very often go on leashes, so even though I do use harnesses, most of the time they're off leash. But I have heard some really good stuff about both those harnesses. I just think they have different applications. But, you know, again, it's very much, I mean, and I think, and, you know, you tell me, Ada, you obviously know a lot more about it than I do. I'm not a harness expert in any stretch of the imagination. But there are obviously ways that they should be properly fitted. And
well, absolutely. If they're not properly fitted, and usually with my students, they had, and I also recommended harnesses that actually had a strap across the chest, that they just didn't fit right. They'd be below the chest and it would hinder the shoulders. It would crawl up right behind their pit of their front arms, causing chafing. And therefore, the harness, like Nancy's or balance or walking in sync, in fact, are fitted so that they're probably an inch to 2 inches or more behind the front legs.
Right, right.
So it's not uncomfortable. With the other harnesses, the dogs would be scratching at their harness, and you could just see it was uncomfortable.
Yeah. So in your group classes or in your private lessons, do you address equipment as a sort of first port of call?
Oh, absolutely. With and I tell folks, you're welcome to wear a collar if your dog does not pull. As soon as I see the dog choke, a harness is required.
Right,
and
right.
As of yet, everyone had to come with a harness.
Right, right. Interesting. So, well, I know some daycare operators actually insist that all dogs in daycare have a harness because it's a safe way of also, you know, grabbing dogs as well. So
right.
if something goes wrong, and I know a lot of daycare facilities prefer dogs to be so-called naked, but I do know a few that use harnesses. Yeah, it's amazing, isn't it, over the last few years how many harnesses have suddenly hit the marketplace, and they all seems to have been a lot more thought put into the design of them in terms of the dog's comfort.
Yes, absolutely. Because if they're uncomfortable, they're going to be stressed. And this yeah. is what we're trying to avoid.
Yeah. Well, while we're talking about harnesses, let's get Di Garrod on because Di, I know through Tellington T-Touch, Di's has some strong opinions about harnesses and also having two points of contact. So, Di, are you there?
Yes, good morning.
Hey, well, it's actually afternoon here for us on the East Coast.
Oh, that's right. Well, you know, we age less here in the Pacific Northwest.
is that because the weather's always so cold, Di?
Oh, no. It's beautiful, sunny in Washington State right now.
Well, thanks for joining us. I'd invited the steering committee to jump on today onto our first show. So, Di,
sure.
Thanks so much for being here. So we're here talking to Ada about the article "Ask the Dog" that she did for Barks March. It's a nice article about how to correctly and incorrectly fit harnesses. And then Ada talks about harnesses with V-shaped chest straps and harnesses with straight chest straps. So what are your thoughts on harnesses, Di? Which ones do you prefer?
Well, I do. I have tried them all, and so my preferences may vary a little bit from what others do. But I do three basic harnesses. I do like Nancy's dog reins. I've used them for several dogs now, and leash reactive dogs, and it is just pretty amazing once the learning curve is accomplished as to how the dog responds to that particular harness. Nancy can give a lot more specifics, and there is a video at dogreins.com so that you can see it in operation. I also am a certified Tellington Touch practitioner, so I do like the Tellington Touch step-in harness and two points of contact, especially for dogs that are lunging or aggressive, reactive. We have to take the lunging away, and so two points of contact is really very important, and it is not confrontational to them. Their neck isn't in jeopardy. I mean, there's a lot happening around that neck area. You've got your thyroid and esophagus and the spinal cord connection, and it just seems, you know, plausible that the harness is much better for the dog, because if you took a stick and put it between the dog's shoulder and it came out on the chest, that's where the dog has their equilibrium, where they're balanced, and it's a lot more solid connection to the dog so that you can influence their behavior. And then the last one that I like actually just slips over the head for really hard to work with dogs. Clean Run did a review on this particular harness. I believe it's called the Comfort Harness, and it slips over the neck and velcros really quickly to the body in case you have a dog that is really aversive to having a harness put on. I really like it also for dog sports and for tracking or anything that you need a specialized harness for. So,
right.
So those are my choices, although I have used all of them.
Yeah, and I think, you know, and I think, Di, that's the key, isn't it, that we shouldn't be judging other people for the choice of equipment. If the equipment fits correctly and it's safe and the dog's okay with it, then, you know, use what you as the consumer feel comfortable.
Right, and dogs are individuals, and so we have to use what the dog as an individual feels comfortable with as well.
Absolutely. So, well, I'm just going to do a quick plug for one of our vendors or an organization that works with us, and that's the Journal of Veterinary Behavior. The Journal of Veterinary Behavior, the senior editor of this is Dr. Karen Overall, and we became affiliated with them last year. So if members of PPG don't know, then I'm going to tell you right now that you can subscribe for $30 for the electronic version or $45 for the paper. And the non-member rates for this journal are $168 a year. So that in itself pays for your PPG membership. So if you don't receive that or you're not subscribed, I strongly recommend you do. There are some fantastic scientific articles in the Journal of Veterinary Behavior. There's some great stuff in there. And if you're interested in doing that, then go to the member area where you can sign up. And I'm also going to do a plug here for the Business Insurers of the Carolinas, because David Pearsall was one of the very first vendors to join PPG back 3 years ago. He has supported us through thick and thin. He was the first vendor to write a $4,000 check to sponsor our summit without any questions asked. So I'm a big believer in being loyal to those that support us. So if you're looking for insurance for your business, go to Business Insurers of the Carolinas. There is an application form. They now have an electronic form you can fill out online for PPG members. If it doesn't state anything there that seems like is suitable for you, then give them a call. They're really nice to work with. We've used them for insuring physical buildings and liability. Our board members are insured through Business Insurers of the Carolinas. So Big shout out for David Pearsall and his team over at Business Insurance of the Carolinas. And they also helped us with the policy for our members, our group master program. When we first wrote that, they removed from the language of the insurance policy chock, shock, choke, and prong. So if a member or somebody's using one of those pieces of equipment and they have an insurance claim, the claim will not be paid. So that's another great way that they've supported us in terms of supporting our mission. So that's to David and his team. So we only have a few minutes left. So I think, Louise, we need to talk about, and I'm going to keep Ada and Diane so that they can sort of chirp in as well, if you so desire to chirp, or you can talk, whichever you prefer. Let's talk about Dog Gone Safe and their Dog Bite Safety Initiative, because they do this every year.
So. They do. And I think, to be honest, what Dog Gone Safe do is that they get the information out there to people. They share the education in schools. They've got their Be a Tree program. They're teaching children how they need to behave around dogs,
yeah.
Which is so important. Because whether we're talking about children or adults, I think education is the key. People in general don't know quite enough about dog body language. They don't understand when a dog is anxious or stressed. And I do think that dog bite awareness and prevention, it is just so important.
It's huge. And you know, the months of March, April, and May are the International Bug Bite Prevention Challenge that Joanna and her team do. And they are challenging the members and the Be a Tree presenters to educate 50,000 children about safety around dogs. So if you're not part of the Be a Tree program, but you are interested in doing that, then go to doggonesafe.com. They have a great program called Be a Tree. They provide great tools. You have the resources to go into schools or scout groups. It's an international program. It's available in several languages now. It's just fantastic. Anyway, every year they do this. It's a wonderful challenge, and I hope that a lot of our members get involved, because at the end of the day, like Louise said, it's all about teaching children how to be safe around dogs. And with that said, we ran a 5-day workshop here a few weeks ago for professional dog trainers and pet care providers, and I was amazed at the people sitting in the room, how many of them had not ever covered canine communication and social behavior as a sort of formal topic, and didn't understand some of the nomenclature that we were using or some of the more subtle signs of when a dog is stressed. So, you know, I personally feel, and I will get on my platform here, I personally feel that anyone working in our industry, it doesn't matter what you do, you have an obligation to the safety of your four-legged clients to be able to communicate with them appropriately. So if you feel that you need some education, then look around. There are some great educational providers just to sort of fill in that gap or that vacuum. So I don't know, anything else we've got time to talk about today? Di, Ada, is anything that you'd like to add? We're almost at our hour, which means this show has gone incredibly quickly.
Well, I just want to say that there's so many exciting things coming up with PPG that if you're really into fear-free training, force-free, then you really have an opportunity, and there are no more excuses to get involved.
Yep, and we have, you know, with that said, thank you for reminding me, we have, if anyone's asking how did you find the people for the pilot program, for the credentialing program, the answer is we first went out to those who have volunteered for PPG, because we're not able to pay volunteers, and they bring so much to the organization. I mean, you know, Rebecca and I are very much the sort of face of PPG, but there are lots of people, hundreds of people working behind us, helping us achieve everything that we achieve, helping us get the message out there, helping us make sure that we can service the members. So thank you to all those volunteers, whether you work on the education committee or the advocacy committee or the summit committee or the marketing committee with Di, just loads of great people there just helping us each and every day. It doesn't require a lot, but it does require a lot of us to do a little, and that's why we're able to get so much stuff done. So thank you to that. So they're the people that we went to first, and if they were eligible, then we invited them to join in with the pilot first. So I hope that we have brought you some chat, chuckle, and sharing. That is our goal. It is our intention. We're going to do this every month. We're hoping that more and more of you join us. We're hoping that you find it valuable. We ask and solicit for your feedback. Please don't tell me I speak too quickly, because I know that's exactly what you're going to say. I try so hard. I try so hard to slow down. Thanks for Rebecca for joining us on a Sunday. Louise, it's been a hoot.
It's been great. Yay. And just one thing, Diane, I didn't get to ask you any questions at all. Will you come back on at a future date?
Oh, I'd love to. I'd love to. Just let me know what the time frames look like.
Brilliant. Thank you.
So, Ada, thank you so much for not only contributing a great article to Barks, but also coming on and chatting with us about it.
And one more thing, Ada, I love your little phrase, be the cookie for your dog. Love it. Be the cookie for your dog.
I know. I didn't coin that one, that's for sure. And I wanted to say hi to Diane, who...
Hi, Ada.
Hi, Diane. It's so good
love
to
you.
I love you, too.
Oh, my God, we got a mutual admiration society going here. That's too funny. Hey, listen, you guys, I just, you know what, Susan Nilsson, I got to tell you, that woman's wonderful.
Yes.
She produces the most amazing publication, Barks and the Guild. I mean, I look at it, and I have a printed version in my hand right now. It is as good, if not better, than other organizations' publications.
Absolutely.
We are trying desperately to find printers that can get the price down for us, because I know it's expensive right now. And we can't give it out for free because our membership rates are so low. But, you know, if you happen to pass by Susan, just give her a high five and tell her what a great job she's doing, because she has done an amazing job of bringing together some great contributors. And with that, thank you so much to everyone that writes for Barks. I mean, there's just God, we're such a talented bunch of people. We have some amazing talent in our organization. And it's so nice to see it all come into the forefront and being appreciated by everybody else. So... thank you, thank you, thank you to everybody.
Well, thank you for inviting me. It was great to talk to everyone.
You're welcome. So we will see you next time, guys. Have a fantastic weekend.
Yay. See you next time.
I'll be there.
Bye, Laura. Bye, Ada. Bye-bye.
Bye.